to a brand new video from me, Pickles Park Up Reviews. Now today, I will be reviewing the 4th episode of Doctor Who Series 11, titled Arachnids in the UK. Or as it should have been titled, Arachnids in Sheffield, or Spiders in Sheffield, or Hotel Arachnophobia. I don't know, but Arachnids in the UK as a title wasn't that accurate, because the spiders were actually only in Sheffield and not in the whole of the UK. I thought this episode was going to be like a really meh one, to be honest. I thought it was just going to be there, it was going to be alright, but it wasn't going to be bad, it wasn't going to be good, it was just going to be a bit forgettable. Now that is what many people perceive it to be now, but I actually really, really enjoyed this one. And I'd say it's one of the best in the series, in my opinion. I thought it was very Doctor Who-y, had a real Doctor Who feel. And many people said that last week's episode was very Doctor Who-y, which I'd agree, but this is also very Doctor Who, but in a different way. Last week's was very Doctor Who-y in the sense that it felt very 60s, it was a historical, and it felt quite educational. This feels very Doctor Who-y in the sense it feels very early 70s, it feels Pertwee-esque, in the sense, you know, it's earthbound, strange things going across the city, you know, enhanced, spiders, you know, a shady corporation who are not quite who they cracked out to be, it felt very Doctor Who-y in that respect, so it felt very classic, you know, although it may have been like a test of formula we've seen before, it was just nice to see it again, and it made for a really enjoyable Doctor Who story. Talk about this early on, the direction and the music. So let's start with the direction by Sally Aprahamian, I do believe. It's the first episode she's directed this series. It's the third director we've got this series, because the first episode, The Woman Who Felled Worth, was directed by Jimmy Childs, and then The Ghost Monument and Rosa were both directed by Mark Tondere. So this one's directed by Sally Aprahamian, and I think it's quite good actually. The direction's almost understated, there's not many weird angles or something, but I think it is actually really quite nice, and there's some nice shots, like when that guy's being dragged down the bathtub and things, and there's a really nice shot when the doctor's on the whiteboard and she joins up all the things and then points in the center, and then it like fades into the actual hotel, which is obviously the center, and that is a really nice shot. And I'd say the direction by Sally Aprahamian was a bit understated, was also really good. It by Sega Nakanova just keeps getting better and better. I really enjoyed the music in this. It almost felt slightly different. You know, had a lot of like violins to play the usual themes, like the TARDIS theme and the Doctor's theme. But there's some really nice like techno music as well, which I really quite enjoyed. I think his score is getting really, really good in this series. The major things for this series was we're actually going to see Yaz's family in this episode. And we do. We have the mum, the dad and her sister, and yeah, they are okay, actually, they're alright. The dad and the sister, I thought were quite good, were quite good characters. The mum was probably the most boring one, she didn't really get a lot to do, and that's kind of a problem, because she's the one we spend the most time with. The only thing she does, really, is that she thinks that Yaz is seeing maybe one of them, and she keeps asking whenever she's with like Ryan or the Doctor, oh, are you two a thing? Which is, I suppose, is quite a mumsy thing to do. But apart from that, no, she doesn't really do a lot, and she's quite boring. The family is quite alright, if a bit, I know, like mundane and boring, but I suppose that's kind of the point, because they're supposed to be boring because they're like a family, you know, supposed to be boring because that's where she wants to get away from them. So yeah, I suppose they were all right, but they weren't in it as much as you probably would have thought, as the trailers would have been suggesting. Got some guest characters in this episode. Now it's always going to be a struggle with this new series of Doctor Who, how they work the guest characters, seeing as we have such a big TARDIS team. I already spoke about the mum. We have Jade McIntyre, I do believe her name is. I wouldn't have remembered it, I just wrote it down on my notes. Also known as Scientist Woman. She's quite good, it's a good performance, and she's an interesting character. Although she does just kind of just spout exposition for all the spiders and stuff. And really, her character may not have been needed, and you could have given a lot of the dialogue to the Doctor. But I was glad she was kind of there, because I wouldn't want the Doctor just being someone who just spouts exposition all the time, like she was in the Ghost Monument. So it was nice to have this extra character there. Whether she is fully needed, I'm not sure. But she has a nice inclusion and gave a good performance. The other big guest character is the businessman, known as Jack Robertson. He was quite a good character. I enjoyed watching him on screen. I think that he is a nice character to have in this. Obviously, he's like the corporate business guy who's obviously a bit of a dick. And, you know, the Doctor doesn't like, and he's not, you know, he feels that kind of stereotype, but I think Chris North gives a good performance. He's a joy to watch whenever he's on screen. I think obviously his character is written very much to be like Trump, but then they mention Trump that he doesn't, and he doesn't like Trump's act. It's a bit of a weird moment, because you're supposed to, he's written to be a bit like Trump, but then obviously they reference Trump and he doesn't like Trump, so don't know. That was a bit of a weird moment. He walks off at the end, so perhaps we'll see him again maybe in 2020 when he is president. That would be quite interesting. But yeah, I suppose he is technically the villain of this episode, although not that. I wouldn't say there's a direct bad guy in this episode really, which was a problem I had in the Ghost Monument, and I think this series is kind of struggling with villains. In this episode, I didn't mind it as much. I think that the quote-unquote villains worked quite well in this story, but I think in future episodes, we really need to start seeing some good villains. Speaking of the villains, though, let's get on to these spiders. I thought these spiders were really quite good, actually, and quite effective. They didn't scare me in the slightest, because I do not have arachnophobia at all. Spiders don't freak me out. But my sister was quite creeped out by them, and looking at the response on Twitter and things, a lot of people were quite creeped out by them. And I only hope that children were scared of these spiders, because that would be quite nice, you know. Halloween is literally just around the corner, so it would be really nice, you know, to, you know, scare some children again. You know, it obviously played on a basic fear that most people have. Obviously, I don't, but arachnophobia is probably one of the most common phobias, and obviously it played on that. And they had a lot of the things that people get freaked out about spiders, you know, the scuttling along the floor, you know, them on the ceiling, the webs. So I think they were quite well done, definitely better done than those weird spider germ things in Kill the Moon. Obviously, these spiders, they were not related to the spiders in Planet of Spiders. And there was actually no reference to Planet of the Spiders. I reckon if this was a Moffat script, it would have been. There would have been a reference, a bit like in the God Complex, where you have the Minotaur, and he says, the Doctor says, a distant cousin of the Nymon. So I reckon if this was a Moffat script, or was it was overseen by Moffat, I reckon there would have been a little reference to Planet of the Spiders in there. There wasn't, because it's a Chibnall script, but yeah, I thought they were quite effective. Obviously, didn't scare me, but I thought they were quite effective. And the visuals, the spiders looked very good. The CGI was really good, and you can still definitely see that the budget has been raised for the series, because, you know, they looked so much better than those spider germs in Kill the Moon. Maybe when they're in really broad daylight, they don't look like brilliant like the big spider, but I thought in terms of Doctor Who standards, I thought they looked really well and really convincing. And talking about another visual, you know, we see the time vortex, which is actually nothing like what we see in the opening titles, which is nice. I really like this time vortex, you know. It's very messy, you know, all over the place, very confusing. You know, it's not one shape or one colour or one, you know, it is all random, and then you have the different tunnels going off to different times, which I thought was a really nice idea. I'm surprised that hasn't been done before. So I thought it was a really inventive, very creative way to, you know, show the time vortex. So that was really nice, and I hope we see more kind of stuff like that in the future. The atmosphere created in the story is really good. You know, it starts off quite dark, and then obviously we get kind of funny bits. But I think you always kind of say that it's a threat. You know, the spiders, and there's always this kind of dark atmosphere underlying it, which I thought was very nice. I haven't felt like that, anything like that from a Doctor Who story for quite a while. I think a story like this, although it's a tried and tested basic formula, hasn't been done in a while, or hasn't been done well in a while. So it was quite refreshing to see that. And I suppose you could count this story as a base under siege in parts, because they're stuck in the hotel. That possibly could have been done a bit more. Oh no, I would have liked that. Maybe you spent more time in the hotel. Maybe if we got learnt more of the geography in the hotel in terms of where everything is when they randomly went into the kitchen, it was maybe make that base under siege aspect a bit stronger. But I thought it was nice, and you know, it's a tried and tested formula. We've seen this type of story done so many times before, but it was just nice to see it done again and done well, and I really enjoyed it. About the TARDIS team, or Team TARDIS as they're called by the Doctor at the end of the episode. Starting off with Bradley Walsh, he's brilliant. You know, he really is stealing the show, not necessarily from the Doctor, but in terms of the companions and all other characters. You know, he's really brilliant whenever he's on screen, you know, playing an almost a bit of like a Wilf character, you know, I think. Especially in the early episodes, if you take a lot of Bradley Walsh's dialogue and gave it to Bernard Cribbins, you can kind of hear it. But no, I think he's really good, and he's obviously got really good comedic presence, but also with the serious stuff as well. Bradley Walsh is really good, like when he's doing the whole grief stuff. You know, he plays that really well, and especially that speech he gives at the end of the episode about the grief. Bradley Walsh plays it brilliantly, so I'm really enjoying Graham's character. Let's talk about Ryan. He doesn't have too much to do in this episode, but he's still good. I think Tosin Cole gives a good performance. Some people are still a bit iffy on his acting, but I still think he's quite good. And obviously he had less to do in this episode, but yeah, I thought he was alright. And finally we have Mandip Gill as Yaz. Obviously this episode, I thought we might see a bit more of Yaz. We did, obviously. Her character still, she feels the most hollow. Obviously we met her family and things, but we still didn't learn a lot about her. We did get that line that she's perhaps, you know, wrapped up in her work a lot of the time and doesn't have that much time for friends and stuff. But we don't learn a lot about her. And obviously we'll get another Yaz-centric episode with Demons in the Punjab in a couple of episodes' time. But maybe it would have been nice to have a bit more focus on Yaz in this episode. But I don't know if there would have been space for that. I'm not really sure. But yeah, she's alright. I still want more. She still feels the most hollow out of all of the TARDIS. The whole idea why the spiders are like this is because the hotel has been repurposed. It's been built on unused mines. And then they filled it with landfill underneath. Which actually, you can kind of see where the company were kind of coming from in terms of, on paper, it doesn't sound like a bad idea to fill the unused mines with landfill. You know, it doesn't sound like a bad idea, but naturally it obviously is. They try to cut corners too much, and there's landfill is all toxic, and then obviously the company in which the scientist woman works at, she gave the carcasses and they put it in the landfill, and maybe one was still alive, and then the spider got radioactive and then made all the other spiders radioactive. I know, or had the radioactive babies, I think it's supposed to be implied. That's what happened, which is alright. They weren't aliens, they weren't synthetic robotic spiders, which I thought maybe they might be. They were just, you know, spiders that were radioactive. I was possibly expecting, you know, a Spider-Man joke, but no, it never happened. But no, I think it's a decent idea in terms of company, and obviously avoids the alien or robotic spiders trope. Yeah, we have more inclusion of pop music in this episode. It seems to be a running theme that we have the pop music. Obviously, we had the song Glorious in a couple of the trailers, which I wasn't a big fan of. Then we have Rise Up last week, which I wasn't a big fan of. I thought the placement there was really wrong, and the scene should have just been played silently for more effect. And we get more in this episode. We have Stormzy being played to lure all the spiders into the room. This is probably the best inclusion of the pop music in the series so far. You know, obviously it was played for more of a joke, and I think it worked. I'm just getting a bit worried, because obviously the Doctor also references Ed Sheeran, that maybe this series is trying too much to try and be topical and be right now, and then when you watch it in a few years time, it all feel very dated to the specific era it's in. Obviously it mentions Trump as well, you know, when you watch it maybe just in 6 years time, you know, it's gonna feel very dated. So, you know, I can kind of see what they're trying to do to try and, you know, make it feel a bit more, you know, topical right now, make it link, but I think it might make it worse in the long run on rewatchability. Talk about the Doctor, Jodie Whittaker. Now she does seem a bit, she's very eccentric in this episode, and I almost kind of see her doing a bit of a McCoy thing. You know, most Doctors, they actually start out more serious, and then towards the end, they almost become a bit more of a caricature of their own Doctor. You know, certain traits, usually the more wackier traits, you know, get overemphasized. That happened with Tom Baker, David Tennant, when with the "Where?" and all that, you know, he put that right up to 11. And obviously Matt Smith, he gets more goofier and childlike over time. I'd say he's more of a mad professor in series 5, but in series 7, he's more of like a child in his eccentricity. Yeah, it seems that she's always doing the reverse, a bit like McCoy, where she starts out more, you know, goofy and silly, and then towards the end she'll get more serious. Maybe she'll even get like the darker jacket, just like McCoy did. He is very eccentric in this episode. A lot of the dialogue, I can imagine Matt Smith almost saying this. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, because although I do really love Matt Smith's Doctor, and Jodie reminds me of that, so I'm naturally really enjoying her Doctor, I don't want her to just be a pale imitation of Matt Smith's Doctor. I'd like her to maybe be a bit more, which I'm sure we will see in future installments. But yeah, I thought Jodie played this really well. But one thing that is a bit odd is not Jodie herself, but the script, the Doctor's morals. So basically Robertson, he just wants to use the gun and he wants to shoot the big spider in the room, which obviously at first you almost think, yeah, that sounds bad because he wants to use guns and the Doctor's against guns. But when you actually think about it, shooting it, the spider's dying anyway, so actually shooting it and giving it like a quick death would be the more humane thing to do than just lock it in the room and let it suffocate itself to death and let it suffer. So really the Doctor is almost shouting at him, saying that this would have been the more humane thing to do, but when you think about it, it wouldn't really be the most humane thing to do. So it's a bit of an odd piece of writing there. I think they kind of got that wrong. Yeah, I hope that Chibnall sorts that out in future episodes. That didn't really make sense to me. So at the end, the journey continues. All the companions realise that where they did just want to go home, now they realise that they do, and the TARDIS team all become the TARDIS team and actually officially step on board. And it's almost like a reintroduction. I really like it. I think obviously I touched on it before, but Bradley Walsh's speech about grief, I think is really good, and he has a really good reason to go on there. And it just gets you excited for the next episode. I think the Trezoranga conundrum, I don't know how to pronounce it, but yeah, now they're a proper TARDIS team, that's really got me excited for the next episode. So overall for this episode, I really enjoyed it. Some people might say it's a bit formulaic, a bit boring, you know, we've seen this all before, but I like that about it. You know, we haven't had a good story like this, although it's formulaic, for quite a while, and I thought the atmosphere was really good. You know, it was kind of a base under siege. It was almost a combination of a Troughton story and a Pertwee story. It felt very Doctor Who-y, you know, Shady Corporation, not doing what they're supposed to do, you know. I thought it was really good. It was directed and scored really well. Yaz's family were a bit boring, but I suppose that was the point. The guest characters, although there were a lot of them, the performances were all really good. And overall, I felt it was a really enjoyable watch, and I was not bored at once. The only criticism is perhaps the mum was a bit too boring, as she was the character we spent the most of out of Yaz's family, and she was the most boring out of all of them. And the Doctor's morals at the end didn't really make sense, in my opinion. Apart from that, I thought it was really, really good, and I really, really enjoyed this episode, which is a nice surprise, as I thought it was just going to be a bit meh. I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10. The same score I gave The Woman Who Fell to Earth and also Rosa last week. I definitely enjoyed it more than Rosa. And I may be The Woman Who Fell to Earth, so I couldn't, definitely say that. But I really enjoyed it. And it's odd how all these episodes just seem to be 8. I was maybe potentially giving it maybe an 8.5, but I think the Doctor's morals gave it down to an 8. And also, while I really enjoyed it, I'm not sure if I enjoyed it over those other two. So far there are 3 episodes that are 8s out of 10s. I really enjoyed this episode, and let's bring on next week's. So, thank you guys for watching. Obviously, I will be doing previews and reviews for every single episode of Series 11, so stay tuned for that. Leave a like if you've enjoyed this episode, and leave a sub if you want to see more content, and hit the notification bell as well. Thank you guys for watching, and of course, a goodbye.